A few years ago, I published a video about fertility problems caused by having high levels of the hormone prolactin. Since then, I have received many questions asking about the best medications used to treat high prolactin levels. In today's episode, I will discuss the medications used to help your fertility. Before we talk about the medications to treat high prolactin levels, I want to briefly review who should be treated. The first step is to have a blood test to measure your prolactin levels. Unfortunately, there are two systems of measurement which can be really confusing. Here in the United States, we use conventional units. For the hormone prolactin, you will most commonly see the measurement nanograms per milliliter. In other areas of the world, you may see measurements using SI units. This is also known as Le Système International des Unités. An SI measurement for prolactin is given as micrograms per liter or milli-international units per liter. The actual number will not change. For example, 25 nanograms per milliliter equals 25 milli-international units per liter. However, if for some reason your lab gives you a measurement of nanomoles per liter, then you will need to convert it using this equation. There are also many websites that can convert it for you. For the rest of this video, we will use conventional units. High prolactin levels are the ones that we are interested in treating. What is a normal prolactin level? Normal levels can vary from one laboratory to another because there are differences in how hormones like prolactin can be measured. For example, a large laboratory in the USA called LabCorp has a normal range from 4.8 to 23.3. Quest Diagnostics has a normal range between 3 and 30. A level of 28 would be high at LabCorp, but normal at Quest. Be sure you and your doctor know the normal ranges of the lab you are using. How and when you measure prolactin can influence your levels. Levels should be measured in the morning after an overnight fast, soon after your period has started, but before ovulation. You should also make sure to not stimulate your nipples. For example, don't wear a tight bra before testing. If your prolactin levels come back high, there is a second test to look specifically at your monomeric prolactin levels. There are several types of prolactin, but only monomeric prolactin levels are important. I talk more about that in my previous prolactin video. Before starting treatment, make sure you rule out other causes for high prolactin levels, such as medications you might be taking or problems with your thyroid. Finally, you have accurately tested your prolactin levels, have high levels, and have ruled out other causes. You are ready to start treatment. Based on where you live, there may be different medications that are available to treat high prolactin levels. Here in the United States, there are two medications which are used most commonly. The first is called Bromocriptine. It is sold under the brand name Parlodel. These are some of the other brands of Bromocriptine around the world. Bromocriptine is an oral pill which is taken every day. Its most common side effects are nausea and dizziness. To help alleviate those side effects, it is best to take Bromocriptine at bedtime with some food. For some people, side effects can be reduced by placing the pill vaginally instead of orally. Your doctor will likely start on the lowest dose possible, even half a tablet, and then recheck your prolactin levels. If they come back still high, then the dose can be increased. Cabergoline is another oral medication, but is only taken once or twice a week. The brand sold in the US is Dostinex. These are some of the other brands of cabergoline around the world. Cabergoline has become more popular since the side effects of nausea and dizziness are less common and less severe than with bromocriptine. People also like the fact that you don't have to take it every day. Which treatment is the best? There was one study which compiled a number of studies comparing bromocriptine and cabergoline. They concluded that with a high degree of certainty that cabergoline was better for people who stopped having their periods because of high prolactin levels. As far as pregnancy rates, they also concluded that cabergoline was better, but because the quality quality of the studies they reviewed was not as good, that conclusion was somewhat less certain. One thing to keep in mind is that cabergoline is a more expensive medication than bromocriptine. For that reason, many physicians may opt to start with bromocriptine and then switch to cabergoline if the patient was having persistent side effects or if they were unable to lower the prolactin levels into the normal range. For most people who start medication to control their prolactin levels, they will see normal levels within about 2 to 3 weeks, but some may take longer. Our Infertility TV bottom line is this: both bromocriptine and cabergoline can be used to treat high prolactin levels. If all you are trying to do is get your periods back, cabergoline may be better for you. If you are trying to conceive, the choice is less certain. Bromocriptine is less expensive than cabergoline, but has to be taken more often and may have more side effects. Infertility TV is your most trusted source for accurate information on infertility and miscarriage. If you are not a subscriber yet, hit the subscribe button right now. A new episode is released every week. Don't miss any episodes. You can also check us out on our website, IVF1.com, where you can become a patient.